Hello, I'm Rene Descartes. I'm honored you want to read my meditations on first philosophy. For those not intimately familiar with Europe in the 17th century, you should know that I wrote and published this work just a few short years after Galileo's condemnation and his house arrest. These were dangerous times for original ideas. Thus, you might understand why I opened my book with a letter of dedication to the most wise and distinguished men, the dean and the doctors of the Faculty of Sacred Theology of Paris at the Sorbonne. I am confident that with their patronage, all will come to see that in my meditations I give most certain and evident demonstrations on two points, all of which are taught in the Holy Scriptures, that God exists, and that there is a real distinction between the soul and the body. I trust, dear reader, that you are familiar with my Discourse on Method, where I explain that the only way to ensure the discovery of certain truth is to reject all that can be doubted. That is, if a claim can be doubted, it must be considered false. Few have the courage and temperament to follow my example, but if, like me, you value truth above all else, then I invite you to join my meditation tonight. I am trying to free your mind, but I can only show you the door. You're the one that has to walk through it. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, and this video and philosophy class ends. You wake up in your familiar bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill. You stay in philosophy class, and I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more. Follow me. When I consider all the things I think are true, I quickly realize that the great majority of such truth claims start with my senses. We universally trust that we sense, and all say they know the sun exists because they see its light and feel its heat. Sensation is all around us. You see such reality when you look out your window, when you turn on your television. You feel it when you go to work, when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. But isn't it equally obvious that your senses have often deceived you? Examples of such lies abound. A straight stick looks bent in water. A cool oasis appears in the dry desert. And the itch of an amputee's missing leg keeps him up at night. Are you convinced that what you sense is real? How do you define real? If you're talking about what you can feel, what you can smell, what you can taste and see, then real is simply electrical signals interpreted by your brain. Sensation isn't real. My method tells me to never trust what has deceived me even once. So, following my method of doubt, I must reject all knowledge claims that depend upon what I see, hear, taste, smell, or feel. All such claims, which are many, I now must recognize to be false. Sensation is a prison that you cannot taste or see or touch. It is a prison for your mind. But is rejecting all sense data as false, the first step of my method, already too much? Can I really call false the great majority of things I know about myself and the world around me? Some sensations are so clear and repeated so often that I must accept them as true, right? Like the obvious fact that I have a body, that I'm sitting in this chair and now talking with you. Denying such apparent observations would be nothing short of insanity. To reject what is obvious is what crazy men actually do, as when they think they are kings when they are paupers, or clothed in robes when they are naked, or that their heads are made of clay, gourds, or glass. I am not crazy. Certainly I can determine for myself when to trust my senses and when I can't. Right? And yet, the rejection of all sense data, the first step in my method of doubt, is supported by a second step. That in my dreams, I often accept as true what I later recognize to be false. That is, in my dreams, I experience and accept the very same things insane people do when they are awake. In my dreams, I often imagine I am sitting dressed in my favorite chair when I am actually asleep in bed. During my dreams, everything feels so real. I am confident that I am talking to relatives long dead, that my hands have been replaced by tentacles, and that I am riding through the clouds on a griffin. At the time, I know these things to be real. But when I wake up, I discover that all of the things I thought were true are actually false. So what is to stop you from admitting that you're living in a dream world? I mean, haven't you had that feeling where you're not sure if you're awake or still dreaming? Thus, isn't it a possibility that what you now sense and recognize as reality is just a dream world? Maybe the things before you, like my hands or this chair, are just illusions. Isn't it possible that in a few minutes you will wake up and discover that all you think is true is actually false? Now, some of you might be resisting the obviousness of the truth, but you have to let it all go. Fear, doubt, and disbelief free your mind. You might be willing to admit that your many false dreams give more reasons to doubt the truth of your senses. But you may argue that your fanciful dreams are at least built upon real things, like an objective idea of particular colors, real physical hands and chairs, or actual lions and eagles. You will say, at least those things are real things, even if my personal dreams are false. Likewise, you might argue that the principles of mathematics are always true. That is, 2 + 3 always equals 5. And a square always has 4 equal sides and 4 interior angles of 90 degrees. Don't such examples successfully resist my dream argument and proof that at least some things really exist? Well, have you not heard of God? God apparently has the power to do anything. Isn't it therefore possible that a being who has the power to create something out of nothing might also have the power to make you think the world and everything within it, like colors, some bodily things, and even mathematical principles, exist when in fact they do not? Yes, it would take an incredibly powerful being to make you think that 2 + 3 = 7, or that a square doesn't have 4 sides. But these are the kinds of things God could do. No? Maybe God wouldn't do such things, since he is said to be perfectly good. But couldn't there be an evil genius with infinite power and an equally infinite malevolent desire to deceive us, who could make you think that colors, material things, and numbers exist when in fact they don't? Thus, what could stand against this third radical doubt? My senses are not trustworthy. My dreams confirm I can't trust my intuition of what is real. And I admit it possible that an evil genius may now be deceiving me into believing that the universe exists when in fact it does not. All can be doubted, and according to my method, you must accept this uncomfortable truth and reject all as false. I recognize that it is very difficult to admit that there is nothing among the things you once believed to be true, which it is now not permissible to doubt. But if you want to discover the truth, if such a thing exists, you must reject all these things. Accordingly, you must suppose that an evil genius, and not a supremely good God, is deceiving you, and that all external things, including material objects, colors, and numbers, are nothing more than dreams. There is no spoon. You have no body, no senses, no truth, only doubt. Once again, the idea is hard for everyone to accept. It certainly goes against our customary ways of living. I imagine you might feel like a prisoner who enjoys his dream of liberty and does not want to wake up. You might prefer the comfortable world of illusion over this desert of the real. You might want to fall back into your old opinions, where what you sense is what you consider real. You might regret taking the red pill and think ignorance is bliss. But I urge you to stay strong. Follow my method. Reject as false all that can be doubted. And maybe, just maybe, you will eventually discover that which cannot be doubted. Then you will have certain truth. But that discovery is the topic of my second meditations. Until then, I leave you in a whirlpool of doubt. Goodbye.